I've also decided to try and do a fairly substantial live demo, which in the tradition of Blue Peter could go incredibly badly. But we'll see. There are no children or animals involved, but there are still computers involved, so there's an enormous scope for everything to go horribly wrong. So the idea here is just a very high-level background on HPC. I'm not going to go into any code really at all today. This is more talking about technologies and how to make use of them. And in particular, I don't know if you can quite see it on the screen, but essentially I'm going to focus on GPUs and cloud because I think that that's the kind of stuff that it's hardest to get information on out there. So if you're interested in sort of high-performance computing just with a regular CPU or that kind of thing, or a regular cluster, there's a lot more tutorials and literature on that out there. There's a lot less on GPUs and cloud computing. Okay, so the typical techniques that we would worry about are either CPU-based high-performance computing, or GPU-based, or cluster if you have many machines, or using the cloud if you want to use a service like Amazon EC2 or Microsoft Azure and so on. And so that last section, the cloud, there's only a couple of slides, but that's where I'm going to hopefully actually show you how you can go about setting up cloud systems for yourself if you want to do computing either, well, in any language really, but I'll demonstrate how to set up R very fast. And again, if things go to plan, I'll show how to set up Julia as well, because I know there's some fans of Julia in the room. Okay. So it is important, really, to know these things when you're working in statistics, especially at a research level, and even more so if you go into business. And that's because most of the modern methodology and most of the modern data sets require you to be able to crunch vast quantities of data or complex models very fast. Okay, so just a quick history. So in the 70s, if you look back, it's actually fun to go back and look at a book like Box and Tiao from 73, which in its day was a very highly respected Bayesian stats book. And what you'll see is that conjugacy results abound. Okay, so really you relied on sort of conjugate priors, which would give you the same form for your posterior, because really there wasn't an awful lot else you could do. But when we got to the 1990s, MCMC came in, and then we were able to go mainstream and do all kinds of models, essentially any kind of model you could dream up. But of course, samplers often in those early days, the slow computers would be a bit slow. But what's the problem? You just wait a year. We've got sort of exponential growth in the speed of computers. So just hang around and everything will go a bit faster. And so the CDT students will recognise this slide. I promise I'm going to go quickly through the bit the CDT have seen before, and then we'll try and get on to the demo. So this is what the picture looks like up until the early 2000s. And this green line, which should be a bit bigger, but what you can't see is this purple line here is the clock speed. And notice that you've got a log scale over here. So you've got exponential growth in your clock speed over time. But what you'll also notice is that this blue line, which is power, is also increasing essentially exponentially. And the performance per clock is somehow already starting to taper off. Okay, so remember that the clock speed is just how many things can the CPU do in a second. But if I fill in the rest of this graph and take it a bit later, there's this dramatic plateauing in the clock speed and a complete plateauing in the performance that you can get for every clock cycle as well. So really, since around here, just before 2005, the speed of computers essentially sort of halted. What you will notice, however, is that this green line has carried on going up. And this green line is the number of transistors that you can fit on an individual CPU. And actually what most people don't realize, many people when they quote Moore's law say it's the doubling in the performance, but it's not. Moore talked about a doubling in the number of transistors. And of course, in the early days of computing, if you double the number of transistors, that's roughly equated to doubling the performance. But that's not true anymore because they've reached the sort of maximum power envelope that they can cope with. You can see here the power, because they can't dissipate the heat quickly enough, okay, in that small area. So the point is that we need to have another strategy. We can no longer sit sit back and rely on the code that we wrote last year running twice as fast this year. And that's why this is something that is important to think about as statisticians, even though we're not computer scientists. So in the 2010s, trying to make MCMC parallel friendly really is embedded now as an absolutely firm part of important research directions. The reasons for that really is, of course, we're slightly lagging the computing sector because, of course, we rely on the direction that takes as to what motivates the methodology that we come up with. But really, 2006 was a remarkable year because it was the first year that we had desktop CPUs with more than one core. It was the first year that a public cloud service came out, which would allow you to launch lots of machines in the cloud in 2006. It was also the first year that NVIDIA made it easy to program GPUs. Of course, easy is a relative term because they're still not exactly simple to program, but much simpler than they used to be prior to 2006. And in the roughly 9 years or so since, we've now got 12 core CPUs, we've got nearly 5,000 cores per GPU, and there are many examples of people launching clusters in Amazon EC2 which have more than 50,000 cores on them. Indeed, if anyone was in Lawrence Murray's talk, which was at 2 o'clock, then you will have seen him giving an example where he launched a 128 GPU cluster, which gave him 200,000 GPU cores on a single statistical job. And he finished in 20 minutes what would have taken a month to do on a standard CPU, and what would have taken about 1.5 to 5 years to do if you'd written it in MATLAB or R. Okay, so this makes a big difference. It's the difference between actually being able to do something and not being able to do it. So hopefully I've motivated that this is something we should be interested in. For the enthusiastic, these slides will go up, so don't worry about writing them down, but if you are enthusiastic about this stuff, there's a very interesting sort of history about why the free lunch is over, why we can't just sit back and stuff will get faster for us. And also this is very interesting, welcome to the jungle. What he's referring to there is that it's also no longer enough simply to sit down, write your R code and go away. Okay, you have to think about the fact it could run on a desktop CPU, it might run on you might want it to run on a GPU. And even now, of course, a lot of people are writing mobile phone applications, which might have machine learning algorithms built in that have to run in the constraints of a mobile phone. Okay, so you've got this jungle of different devices that you're going to run on. So for anyone who's not familiar, this is a massively simplified architecture of what your computer looks like inside. And it really is very simplified, and certainly not to scale. So here's your CPU, which would probably be the small one, well, nearly the smallest part of this. And this would be a typical, say, four-core CPU. And the little blue circles are the actual cores that will do the processing. And then I have these things called cache memory, level one, level two, and then there's a shared piece of cache memory, level three. I'm not going to really get into any detail about that today, but if you're interested, feel free to talk to me afterwards. I then have my big chunk of memory. That's the headline figure that you see when you go and buy your computer. So here it's 32 gigabytes. And essentially anything I want to access has to come over this large black slab that I'm indicating here. That's just telling me how quickly I can get to these different parts of the computer. Okay, so my CPU can talk really pretty fast to the main memory. But if my CPU needs to go off and get something from the hard drive, or needs to go off and communicate over the network, you can see, and these bits are to scale, so these black lines are to scale with the rough speed that you're able to access information in these different places. So if I want to access stuff that I've loaded into memory, it's really fast. If I need to go to the hard drive, it is horrifically slow by comparison. And it's much worse news on the network. And the GPU, you can see a massive difference in scale. In fact, this isn't even rendering correctly because there are so many little blue squares here. But each of these blue squares, and I think the one I drew here has something like 2,500, is in some sense, conceptually, the equivalent of a CPU core. Okay. So this is why you really,
you know, if you have a massively parallel algorithm, you really want to care about GPUs and whether you can make use of them.
Okay.
And again, you have a fairly high speed of access to the GPU, but it's not something that you, in reality, would want to flip back and forth accessing too frequently. Okay, and then again, just some more reading points as if anyone does get terribly excited after this. This isn't actually crossed out. That's my modification to the title of his paper. So this paper is actually from 1991, entitled What Every Computer Scientist Should Know About Floating Point Arithmetic. I would argue that actually now it's something that every scientist should know, because pretty much everybody works in science, and in science I obviously include statistics, is going to be implementing all of their algorithms on hardware, which is subject to floating point arithmetic problems. There's also this, which is a very, very detailed and interesting guide to what every programmer should know about memory. So here you could replace programmer with scientist as well. And that's to do with making use of cache memory and so on, so that you get sort of essentially, in some sense, free speed-ups in the work that you're doing. And if you really go off the deep end and get very excited, then this is far more detail than you could ever possibly really want in Agner Fogg's work there. Okay, so just some very general and entirely subjective comments. In other words, this is my thinking on it, and I wouldn't say that this is exhaustive, and other people may have different priorities. But, you know, this is a famous quote, I think, due to Donald Knuth, which is that premature optimization is the root of all evil. But it is absolutely true. When you sit down to start programming, you don't start worrying right from the beginning about how to program it for a GPU or how to write it in C or anything like that. Get it working first, and then measure how fast it is, and use what is called a profiler. Again, I don't have time today to go into that, but you know, look up about how you can make use of profilers to find out which bits you actually should concentrate on speeding up. Don't excessively trust back-of-the-envelope calculations as well. So in statistics, of course, we do an awful lot of sort of computations of the order of the number of operations that will be involved in particular algorithms and so on. But there is an awful lot more going on when you implement these things on a computer. So I wouldn't trust those 100% when you're trying to identify which bits of an algorithm to really focus on dedicating performance improvement to. Just measure it. Use a profiler, see what's happening. The other thing is, you know, getting very extreme parallel programming right is hard. That's just the reality of it. And I don't know anyone who does this stuff seriously who doesn't start out with a serial version that they can just confirm their results are actually something sane. And, you know, that's the kind of thing you should do to satisfy comment two anyway. Why would you parallelize something that is already fast enough?
Okay. Also, don't lose sight of your own time, particularly because I guess almost everyone in here is either a master's or PhD student. And of course, your time is finite, and it's not worth spending hours to get something to run 3 seconds faster. Okay, but clearly it is worth spending hours to get something to run in 20 minutes instead of a year and a half. And so, you know, you might need to replace your favourite high-level language here, R, Python, whatever else, when you can, and C or whatever else when you must. And then finally, this isn't really a performance thing, but just something I would encourage anyone when they're setting out in coding is to really modularize everything that you do, because then it's easy to pull out one thing. Say you have your code nicely split into lots of functions, and you determine which function is slow, then you can simply plug in a parallel version of that. Okay, but if you've got just all your code in one long script file, that's going to be a much harder job to achieve. So that's what I mean when I say modularization. Okay, so I'm just going to give a brief introduction to GPUs. As I said, this is going to be code-free because there's not enough time to go into how you actually program them. And so the objective here really is to give you a conceptual mental model of how GPUs work so that you can perhaps look at the work that you're doing and decide whether you think your problem could fit into the GPU model. And if you think from the mental model that we discussed today that it would fit,
then it's worth going and actually learning how to program these things.
Okay. So we've already said that they're very parallel devices, up to 5,000 cores on the K80s.
And these are the kind of chips that we have on the Grey Ostrich server here. Usually you program in C and C++. They are working hard, actually, at NVIDIA to make these accessible in other languages. But there are interfaces available from Python, from R, from Julia.
And often you can actually make use of the GPU without ever writing a single line of GPU code. And their main mode of operation is this so-called SIMD, which is short for single instruction, multiple data. In other words, I have one instruction, and I want that same instruction to operate identically on a large swathe of data. Although now, in recent releases of CUDA, you can actually launch multiple independent invocations of different code, so it doesn't always have to be the same instruction. And then the final really important thing is that the GPU, so I had this picture earlier here, the GPU has its own chunk of memory here, and it cannot directly access this memory over here. So there's an awful lot of bookkeeping to do. If I want to operate on some data, the first thing that the CPU has to do is pull the data in from main memory and then copy it out onto the GPU. And actually, this can be a real problem. If you've got a fairly simple computation to do, you can often find that the simple act of copying all of the information on and copying it off again takes longer than the computation itself does. Okay, so don't be surprised if you say, oh, I've got this amazing thing that I can massively parallelize, but you end up somehow mysteriously running slower on the GPU. And often that can be because you spend more time simply managing everything. Again, if you're in Lawrence's talk, you will have seen on his compute time graph, he had this interesting sort of effect where he had sort of compute time against some parameter value that he had here, and it seemed to hover like this and then just explode. Okay, and all that meant was that for these low parameter values here, the GPU actually was not taxed at all. Okay, you were limited by time it takes to launch the program, to copy the data on, to copy the data off, and the actual computation was minor. And it was only once you got past this particular parameter value that suddenly the GPU is being stretched. Okay. So this is a bit of a closer look at a GPU. So this is a pretty old GPU. This was the one that was in my old laptop from 2007. But it gives you an idea of how these things are progressing. So a GPU has slightly different nomenclature. I have cores still, but these cores are arranged into groups which are multiprocessors. Okay, so I have, in this case, 8 cores, and I have 4 multiprocessors of 8 cores. They each have a little bit of memory, and then this is the global memory that you saw on the zoomed out version before. That's what the GPU looks like in the laptop that's on the stand here. So, yeah, and this was in 2013, that laptop was bought. So in a very short period of time, 6 years, you can see that even in laptops, the amount of cores you have available are growing substantially. So it's now 2 multiprocessors, but I have 192 cores per multiprocessor. And then that's what it looks like on the CDT compute servers, or if you launch something on the Amazon cloud, this is the kind of setup you have. So in each of these multiprocessors, there are 192 cores, and we've got, what is up to 13 multiprocessors. Okay, so here's where we get to the conceptual view of CUDA.
So when you want to run some code on a GPU, that code is called a kernel, and it's just a C, or actually you can also write C++, a C function. And it's just got a special flag which says it's capable or should be run on a GPU. And the kernel itself is executed on individual cores of a multiprocessor inside what we call a thread. Okay? So for the purposes of getting a mental image of what's going on here, you can just think of a thread as some index J. Okay? So in other words, very, very loosely, that you can think of it as an index into the core number in a particular multiprocessor. And at any given time, there's a whole block of these threads which will execute on a multiprocessor. And so a block could be thought of, again, simply as an index I. So very loosely here, it's an index of the multiprocessor. Okay. So if I have index I equals 2 and j equals 5, then in a very loose sense, which will become clearer in a minute, I'm talking about executing on the second multiprocessor in the fifth core. But the important thing is that the function that gets executed is exactly the same. I write one function, and that function gets executed on all the cores, and the only thing that changes is the index when the function is run. So together, you can think of I and J as corresponding, as I say, to a single core of a single multiprocessor. So very simplistically, you can think about how to parallelize your problem by splitting it into identical chunks indexed by a pair ij. And of course, probably the first thing you think of there is, well, that's essentially, in some sense, a doubly nested for loop. Okay, if I can say for I in some range of values, and then within that loop I have for j in another range of values, if you can write your problem in that way, then you're already sort of 40% of the way to being able to have a mental model of your problem running on a GPU. Okay, if you can't express your parallelism in that way, then you're going to have a lot harder time. It doesn't mean it's impossible, but you might have a lot harder time mapping your problem to these highly parallel devices. So here's what's happening. So conceptually up here is my code. I can think I've got blocks, and in each block I've got threads, which I'm denoting by the little dash arrows. And those get mapped then down here. So note, I've actually got, in this case, I've got a two multiprocessor GPU, but I've got four blocks. But that's fine, because they just queue up, and they run one after the other. So block zero is dispatched to the first multiprocessor, block one to the second, and so on. There are some subtleties here. You're not actually guaranteed that they're in order. And then let's say each of my multiprocessors only has four cores. That's fine as well, because again, the threads are just queued up to run one after the other. Okay. And actually, as I'll allude to in a minute, that is precisely what you want to do. You should always overload a GPU. You must give it more blocks than multiprocessors, and you must give it more threads than cores, as a general rule of thumb. There are strange edge cases where that's not a good thing to do. So you might be thinking, well, so I said there's no code. There's a tiny bit of code. So how does this sort of translate? If I'm running exactly the same function, then how does the function ever do anything different? Well, of course, it's just going to have its particular index. So in this particular thread, the function is called with my I equal to 0 and my j equal to 0. Okay, and I can just create some offset to pick out if I'm going to operate on different values of x. So say I want to calculate a likelihood over a vast amount of data. Then I can compute the likelihood contribution of each data point by simply creating an index where I make jumps of, say, size 50 if I've got 50 threads. So I'm going to jump by chunks of 50 for each block, and within each block I'm just going to jump in one to go across each there. Whereas, say, over here I've got, I'm in block 1, thread 2. Okay, so now I'm operating on the 52nd, or well, 53rd. Data item.
Okay. So here are some, again, just high-level rules, I've called them. It's, of course, all rules can in some sense be broken. So there is a cap, well, this one can't. There's a cap on the number of blocks and threads. And that cap is not related to the size of the GPU, actually. It's simply related to what version of the CUDA software you're using. But those are always much bigger than the physical number of multiprocessing cores you have. You can't assume that things will execute in a particular order. You might be used, when you're running on a CPU, if you write a for loop, you know that, you know, iteration 5 will complete after iteration 4. You don't have any such guarantee on a GPU. Similarly, true of blocks. If you do need to deal with dependency, therefore, you've got to get quite complicated. And this is just a pointer to the thing that you look up if you do decide to look into this stuff in more detail.
The other way to deal with dependency, of course, is to split into multiple kernels. So the one thing you are guaranteed is that if you do two function calls to a GPU, one after the other, then the first function will complete before the second one starts. And then this is an absolutely golden rule. Never ever try and write to the same memory location from different threads. So when I was talking about, say, computing a likelihood in parallel, you definitely couldn't accumulate that likelihood. You couldn't accumulate the sum into a particular variable that was shared amongst all of your processors, because they would all start overwriting each other. Okay. So you would need to compute the likelihoods and then separately do the sum
using a sort of parallel reduction or something.
Good question. Is there such a thing as atomic read and write then for a GPU? It just doesn't exist.
You can do barriers, but there's not an atomic write to global memory. But there are barriers you can put in which emulate an atomic write, but it's not a native operation. And the problem is, because it's not a native operation and you have to have barriers, it generally has a very, very large penalty associated with it in performance. There's this concept of shared memory as well, where those kind of things are easier to do and very much higher performance. But as a general rule of thumb, the easiest way to think about it is that global memory, you can't really operate on atomically.
Not very easily. So then what are some performance considerations? And I'll... where's the time, by the way? So I was told this was supposed to be up to 2 hours, but don't worry, I'm not going to go on for 2 hours. Particularly because there seems to be a very large number of talks on. Okay, so I've picked out three. I mean, the performance considerations with GPUs could fill a book, okay? But I'm just going to pick out the three most important ones, which again are things actually which you might be able to mentally map to a statistical sort of algorithm. So the first is that memory accesses are really slow compared to the cores. Now this is true in a CPU too, but the difference is that CPUs have caches. Now the very latest GPUs also have caches, but they're absolutely tiny by comparison to a CPU. So the reality is that when you try and access memory, your GPU core is going to have to sit and twiddle its thumbs for a substantial amount of time before that memory is available to use. The second issue is that if you have lots of conditional sections in your code, else if, then that's really going to kill performance as well. There are ways to get around this if you have some a priori knowledge about which sections of your data will go one way or the other, but that's getting a bit more advanced. And then the final thing is that if you have very random accesses into memory, that's really going to hurt performance as well. In fact, you can underperform a CPU very easily just by doing random accesses to memory rather than scanning nicely and sequentially across your memory locations. So I'm going to just dig into these three performance considerations, and then we're going to move on to talking about cloud computing.
So the first consideration is that really it's a good idea, I've said this already, but a good idea to have the blocks exceed the number of multiprocessors and the threads exceed the cores. In the worst case, really, you ideally have both equal to the physical device sizes, or otherwise you're explicitly saying that some of your cores are going to sit and do nothing. But in reality, you know, make sure that it exceeds for performance reasons. As I say, it is a simplification. There exist some weird edge cases where this isn't true. And NVIDIA provide this handy, it's regrettable that it is in an Excel spreadsheet, but it's great that they provide it. It's what they call an occupancy calculator. And you can download this spreadsheet and input certain information about your algorithm, and it will tell you roughly what percentage of the CPU capacity you will be using those particular values.
Okay. And why do we want to do this? Why do we want, say, to have many more threads than we have cores?
Well, so as my thread starts to execute, at this point here, I've put a sort of a star to indicate that it's accessing some information from global memory. Now, when this happens, typically a core will sit and do nothing until that memory arrives. And certainly on a CPU, there are sort of complex heuristics that we'll use to decide whether it context switches and starts running something else or not. On a GPU, it's actually very, very easy and very fast for that core to start doing another job, if there is another job waiting. So if you give it more threads than there are cores, there's always something else it can be doing while it's waiting for this to arrive. So it can come to here, it reaches a memory access, and then it has to stall and wait. So it says, well, while I'm waiting for that, I'm going to do some unfinished business I had on thread B. And again, it might reach another stall, and then it will check back, still nothing arrived in response to this request. So it will continue executing on thread C. And again, it might hit another memory access, but by the time it gets here, perhaps the memory that we requested in the original thread has arrived, and now I can resume computing here until the next memory access. So this scheme is called latency hiding. So you can hide the latency of the memory by just, overloading the CPU. So it sounds counterintuitive that if I overload something, it performs better. But that is precisely the case with GPUs. And it's because these threads are so lightweight. So if you try and do this on a CPU, you incur quite a penalty every time you have to switch threads. It's called a context switch. And that's not the case in a GPU. They can do it extremely fast. So in this instance, in other words, if we had this ideal situation, here we would suffer zero compute loss due to memory latency. Okay, because although there is a latency, we were able to do other stuff while we waited. This is how you can understand the issue of conditional clauses. So when you have code, I haven't mentioned this phrase, but I'm just going to throw it out there and then tell you to forget it. But actually what gets executed are what are called warps of threads. Okay. So threads are bunched together into what's called a warp, which is very Star Trek-y. And those warps all have to execute exactly in lockstep. Okay. So whenever, if I have some code, as I have on the left over here, and I have the different data that's executing on each of my cores, they will all arrive at this if statement in the warp. And they will say, okay, if this particular condition is value is greater than zero, then I want you to execute here. Now what's going to happen is that the GPU cores will evaluate the conditional for each of their respective pieces of data. But then the ones that evaluate to true will start to execute through this if section of the if. The ones that evaluate to false, because they're in lockstep, it's like they're tied at the leg in some sort of school race, they have to sit and wait while these chaps execute. And they're not doing anything. I mean, they're not actually running this code, but internally their program counter is pointing to exactly the same lines as they go through. And then, of course, when I get to the else, the situation reverses. All the guys who evaluated to true initially now have to sit and do nothing while they wait for the ones that evaluated to false to complete execution. And then they all join together and they carry on happily. So what you can see is that in the worst case scenario, so a warp is 32 threads. In the worst case scenario, if I had 32 if-else clauses here, and every single one of them evaluated to a different true-false statement across all of the threads, then what I would essentially have is that my entire GPU bunch of cores executes in series, okay, because they're all going to have to wait for each other. So what you can see is actually this is something where you begin to tie this back to development of your statistical methodology, and you say, well, okay, if there's some way that I can say that with high probability, I know some bunch of data will evaluate to true on particular evaluations, and some other bunch will evaluate to false, then simply arrange that data to be blocked together. Because if all of these evaluate to the same thing, if they're all true, then they execute here, and if they're all false, they can jump, because none of them need to execute those. So this is where sort of the stats methodology and the computing sort of come together, and you can really exploit
knowledge of what's going on a GPU to get substantial speedups. Okay, and then the final consideration that I'm going to talk about today, there are many more, is the fact that actually, when you ask for a piece of memory in one of your GPU threads, what you will find is it's not going to just pull in that element that you've asked for. It will actually pull in all the three following values if you were to request, say, a floating point value. Essentially, it pulls in chunks of 128 bits. And it will do that whether you ask for them or not. Okay. Now, this doesn't mean that it's going to mess up your code. It's not going to give them to you. But they will be fetched whether you ask for them or not.
But, of course, you can use that to your advantage.
If you make sure that all of the consecutive iterations of your J-index are accessing consecutive regions of memory, then actually you have to issue a quarter the number of memory accesses as you otherwise would. So let me just go back a bit. In other words, here, let's imagine I'm going to change this scenario and I'm going to say that this is accessing x0, this is accessing x1, and this is accessing x2. Okay. Then what would have happened is that when it got to here, the GPU would have gone and fetched x0, x1, and x2, and x3, all at the same time. And it would have, then when this guy starts to execute, he would have stalled still because they wouldn't have, all three wouldn't have come in. But this chap actually would never stall because when by the time that you reach here, the original memory request is completed. So x2 has come in before we even asked for it. And then all of these threads would be ready to continue execution simultaneously.
Okay, so
that's sort of a mental model of a GPU. Like I said, I promised there would be no code in it. But hopefully it gives you a way of thinking about graphics processors. If you can sort of tick the box on those three performance considerations, if you can map your problem to this IJ indexing, then I would say it's definitely worth investigating. There's an awful lot more subtlety here, but that I would say is sort of a minimum bar to say that there's a good chance you can get something useful out of this. But even if you can't sort of fit your problem into those boxes very easily, don't forget that you might still be able to use GPU tools without ever actually writing GPU code. So there's a whole bunch of different packages you can use from R, GPU tools, GMatrix, Hyperarm, CUDA, Bayes, RAG, YDLM, RPUD, which sadly is costs, RTH, RCUDA, Python, C++, C, they all have different libraries that you can use. And if you want to use these libraries, generally speaking, they don't make any, don't require to make any GPU code yourself. You're just calling different functions in order to execute your problem on the GPU. So, excuse me. For example, in GPU tools, you can do things like Cholesky decomposition of your matrix on the GPU instead of doing it on the CPU. And if it's a sufficiently big matrix, that might actually make a difference. And if you want more, that barely scratches the surface. But there is a course by Mike Giles, who's a professor in applied maths here in Oxford, that he runs over the summer, and anyone who's on the CDT has either done it or is about to do it. Everyone else, though, you're very welcome to sign up. It's £200 for academics. It's a week long, and it goes into an awful lot of detail, and it's here in Oxford, so you don't have to pay any travel or accommodation. I'm sure most people's grants would stretch to £200, and Mike Giles is a leading expert in this stuff. He was the first NVIDIA CUDA fellow in the world in any university. Okay. So, are there any, before I carry on to well, hopefully from your perspective the more exciting bit, from my perspective the more terrifying bit of the talk, where we do the live demo and it all goes wrong. Are there any questions about GPUs? No? Okay.
Okay, so just a few slides on cloud, and then I'll do the demo. So
first thing, of course, is this is a serious buzzword alert, and it means different things depending on who you talk to. Okay.
So for the purpose of what I'm talking about a service which allows you to create and destroy servers, which are virtual in the sense that they aren't necessarily a physical one physical machine. They might be a shared machine with other people from elsewhere around the world. And the key thing is that you should be able to do this remotely without having to worry about hardware and operating system installation. And crucially, what I consider to distinguish true cloud services from not is where the billing is in a very small increment, such as hours or in some cases minutes. There are a bunch of different providers. There's Amazon is the probably the leader in the field at the moment. DigitalOcean is a very interesting sort of younger startup. Google, of course, are in this with Google Compute Engine. Rackspace Cloud Service, which is much more sort of aimed at corporate stuff than computational work. And there's Azure as well, which is run by Microsoft.
Now, I promise you I don't have any shares in Amazon. I'm not particularly plugging them. But there are reasons that I think that Amazon is the one service to look at the moment. And of course, this could change in the future. But right now, I think they're the only ones that tick this list of what I consider subjectively to be important things for scientific high-performance computing. So the first is they have a repository which allows you to do community development of so-called images. This just means that, you know, when I start a machine, it has to boot something, and it has to have some software on it. And Amazon have a repository where they allow people to create their own images so that they can allow other people to boot their software and run them. And as far as I'm concerned, I truly believe that over time, particularly with statistical methodology getting more complex and using more complex hardware, that in some sense, these kinds of repositories, be they run by Amazon or be they run by Docker or someone like that, are going to become the replacement for things like R packages. Okay, so if you've got some statistical analysis you need to do, it's much easier if you can just boot a machine, which is fully configured, and then plug your data in and away you go. Rather than having to set up graphics cards with, you know, which you might have to buy just to do one analysis. The other thing that they allow is permanent storage medium, which again is not something that all of the, so for example, DigitalOcean don't provide this. Billing, which allows you to stop the server and stop paying, but where your machine hard drive is still there. So again, say with DigitalOcean, I think it's true with Google Compute Engine as well, I'm not sure. When you stop the machine, they delete the hard drive. Okay, so you can't then start the machine again. So you have to continually pay as long as even the data exists. A free tier so you can try without paying. And then everything from the micro instances, which are free on Amazon, right through to GPU nodes. So I think Azure might have just introduced GPU nodes recently, but Amazon for a long time were the only ones who provided GPUs for computing. And then finally, this is definitely only true of Amazon at the moment, the stock market for unused capacity. So Amazon have this vast amount of compute power, and anything that's not being used at the moment, you can buy on the cheap, if you like. But you have a trade-off, because if demand rises, they'll kill you. But that's fine. I mean, if we're doing just academic work, which is not on a particular time scale, we can take advantage of really cheap compute power. And if we get killed, oh well, so what? We'll run it again tomorrow and it'll still be cheaper than if we'd paid the full price.
So do they terminate or they pause it?
Terminate, yeah. So actually, one thing I'll show you in the live demo is my own preference when I'm working with these things, for example, is to link a Dropbox account with the server, and then write out intermediate state of the algorithm I'm running to the Dropbox folder, which will automatically sync. And then if I get terminated, that's fine, because it's already synced up to Dropbox, and I can just resume when the stock price drops again. Okay, and then this is just some figures on Amazon.
So it all started because Amazon used to have this enormous capacity that they only needed at Christmas. And so they began selling this spare capacity to other people to use during the rest of the year. And that launched in 2006 from essentially zero. And they went from zero in 2006 to 1.4 million servers by December 2014. They very rarely give these numbers out, so that's the most recent number we have. And they've currently got 28 data centers in 7 countries. These are the places that you can... So you can elect to launch in any of these regions. Yeah.
Does this mean that now it's harder to find server time at Christmas time? Or have they since
updated it? It's now so big that typically that's not an issue. So you may find that the stock price is slightly higher, but it's very rare. I think I've only ever once tried to launch a server and get a no capacity available error. But yeah, I can't remember when it was. But
but also because a lot of the people who use Amazon now are not only retailers. So, for example, the New York Times converted their entire image collection of however many hundreds of millions of images they have from some very old image format to an up-to-date format that they could use on the website. And they launched the whole thing on an Amazon cluster to do it very quickly. And, of course, they don't need to do that at Christmas. So, actually, I think now demand is kind of flattened out. Interestingly, I'm not sure if Amazon eat their own dog food. I don't know if they actually interface with this in the same way that customers do. That would be an interesting thing to know. So here's some jargon so that the demo can hopefully be a bit easier to follow when I get going, because I'll try and go a bit quicker. So EC2 is the name of the cloud service for servers, and it just stands for Elastic Compute Cloud. And so that's, if you talk about launching an EC2 server, that's simply a reference to this service. An instance is their name for a virtual server. Okay, so they don't talk about servers, they talk about instances. S3 is then effectively a very resilient long-term data storage area. Okay, so you can put your data on S3 and then boot your instance and copy it across to do some work and then save it out to S3. And that never goes away unless you explicitly delete it. So it's completely independent of instances, which the other storage I'll talk about in a minute is not. So an AMI is the machine image. This is the thing that I was talking about, people being able to customize and create and share with others. And it's the bundle of the operating system and any preloaded application that boots on an instance. Then a volume. So this refers essentially, you can think of it as a cloud hard drive. Okay. So on Amazon, this is called an EBS, which is Elastic Block Storage. They love the word elastic, it's all over the place. So Elastic Block Storage is essentially like a hard drive. And it sits in the Amazon data center separately from the machine that's running your compute. And then finally, Spot Instance is the name of, is a kind of instance, but it's an instance which can get terminated willy-nilly by the change in prices on the stock market, if you like. Okay. So what could possibly go wrong? This is where we're going to try and do a demo, hopefully. I'll introduce you to... So I've written an AMI myself to make using R easy. I'll show you how to use that. I'll hopefully show you how to set up and use the console to log into these instances. Have a look at spot instances, and then also have a look at Docker containers, which is another way of loading RStudio that is different to the AMI route. And there are also other, well, basically anything you can do on Docker you can do here. So, for example, there's if you're a Julia fan, you can launch Jupyter and use that. You might ask, why did I bother making an AMI when Docker's around? The reason is that this boots in about sort of 60 seconds. Docker, particularly when I did Jupyter, took about 5 minutes, okay, because it first has to boot the image, and then it has to copy the entire Julia image and the entire Jupyter image across from somewhere random on the internet, okay, not internal to Amazon's data center. So that was my own motivation for but the other reason is that, you know, when you install, say, RStudio here, you get just raw R and RStudio. And if you want to use LaTeX or you've got any other big dependencies, you've got to install those as well, and the whole thing can take 10 or 15 minutes just to get set up.
Okay.
But it's much more flexible. So what I would say is the AMI route is easy, but a bit more restricted and fast. The Docker route is completely flexible, much more complicated, and a little bit slower setup time. Okay. So this is the Amazon homepage for their web services. And
what you should see up here is that you can create an account. Well, I've got to sign in, but if you go to my account, you'll get the option to create one. And you just provide your email. You do have to provide a credit card number, but they won't actually bill you unless you use any services. And they also, as I discovered last night when Sebastian was setting one up, they actually call you with an automated phone call to check that you are who you say you are. And they just read a PIN number to you, which you type into the computer. Okay. So I'm just going to sign in here so you can see the console. Okay, so this is what you get when you've logged into into AWS. And the first thing you're presented with is an absolute wall of services. So each of these are different cloud services that Amazon provides. So the crucial one that we're interested in today is up here, because it's related to compute. So you've got EC2, which is how you get instances. EC2 Container Service, if you want to launch Docker instances. Elastic Beanstalk, which is for like scaling clusters. Then down here you've got S3, which is the long-term storage. And those are the only things I'm going to worry about for today. I might not even get around to talking about all of them. If you do this stuff seriously, you'll also at some point need to get familiar with VPC, okay, if you're launching huge clusters by yourself. Okay, so if I just go into EC2, the first thing you have to decide when you go into EC2 is, well, what region do I want to run it in? So if I look up here, these are all the different places that I can launch a server. So geographically, I just tend to choose the nearest one. The prices vary very little across data centers for instances that you request immediately. The stock price, of course, can vary dramatically. And so you want to be a bit more careful in that instance. So the first thing, I'm going to go down the route. I'm going to use sort of just launching in our studio image as an example. But of course you can adapt this to however you want to do it, and it's not restricted to R. If you want to do C or C++ and ignore R completely, that's entirely optional as well. But the first thing you need to set up is what's this so-called security group. Okay, and the reason for that is that your server, your instance, is sitting in Amazon's data center. And by default, it's going to be in complete lockdown. Okay, there'll be no way to get in or out of it. And so the first thing you have to do is create a rule which says, I want to allow these particular services in and out. Okay, so I can create a security group, and I just give it a name. So I'm just going to call it demo, because I'm doing a demo. And then I add rules, and for the purposes of this, I'm going to want to allow SSH. Okay, so if anyone uses the compute servers here in Oxford, if you log into Gate and into Grey Ostrich and all those, you're doing it over SSH. So if we allow SSH, then we'll also be able to do the same thing here. And then the other thing I want to allow is HTTP, and I do that simply because I can access R through a web browser, and when you're in a web browser, that runs over HTTP, which is the hypertext transport protocol. And then I just want to make sure here that I allow from anywhere and to anywhere for both of these. Okay, and then I'll just say create. Okay, and when I look at my demo, I've got other rules you can see here, which I use for other problems. I look at that, and I've got my rule set up for SSH and HTTP. Okay. So, with those set up, I want to make sure I don't forget any steps here. This is the page that I maintain where I list the images. So that's the URL. It's just my site /rstudio_AMI. And these are the AMI tags that you can use to launch in each of these different regions. So let's say I want to launch in Ireland this AMI, then I can just click on this particular link,
And as long as I've logged into my console, it will load. I'm onto the Amazon website now, and it just sends through a tag which has the instance ID. And then you'll see I have this huge list of stuff that I can launch. So these are the different servers or instance types that Amazon will let me launch. So I don't want to end up charging a lot of money, so I'm just going to do an M4 large. This has two CPUs, so it's dual core, and it's got 8 GB of memory. It has no local storage, but it allows you to mount one of these network drives that Amazon has. The one thing I want to stress, I mean, I don't know, everyone has probably had multiple emails from IT here about the speed of network drives. The Amazon network drives are not like that. They are very fast. You will find often that they are faster than standard spinning hard disks in laptops, okay, and you can specify them to be even faster. So if you're the guilty culprit who keeps on crashing the stats network, go and use Amazon instead, okay, and you can ramp up and say whatever amount of I/O capacity you need, okay. So I'm going to choose an M4 large. If you need the details, by the way, on this, it's on the Amazon website. So I can go through here to compute, EC2, and then look at the instance information. Okay, so I get then detailed information. So the one I'm looking at is an M3. So these it gives you the exact CPU type. Okay, so these are Ivy Bridge processors. It tells me that there is SSD local storage, and it gives me the exact information over here. And so again, just in case the culprit is in this room, who keeps crashing our network, these are extremely good. I've actually used these myself in other contexts. These are specifically designed if you need to do a lot of reading and writing from disk. And the biggest of these comes with 8 800 gig SSD drives. And I did do a test once. If you actually link all of these 8 drives together in one big array, you can get about 2.5 gigabytes a second, gigabytes a second, that is, okay, of read-write performance. So that is very, very fast indeed. Right, so going back here, M4 now, I want M3. It's slightly cheaper, the M3. So I'm going to launch my M3. As I go to the next step, there's all sorts of extra stuff I can specify. At the moment, I don't need to worry about this page. When I come back to do Docker, I am going to have to worry about this page. Okay, so hopefully I convince you also that the AMI is slightly easier. I can go to storage. So by default, I get 10 gig. Okay, and this over here, IOPS, tells me the amount of performance I can get out of that drive. Okay, so it guarantees me 30 I/O operations a second, and I can burst to 3,000. And this is linked to the size of the disk. So if I need more performance, I can increase the size of the disk even if I don't need more space. So if I increase that to a 100 gig drive, then what you'll see is these values update. I now get a guaranteed 300 I/O per second, and I can burst to 3,000. And if I really need performance, I just keep going, okay? And then I can get a guaranteed 3,000 I/O per second. Now, I'm not going to launch with a terabyte of space, so just get rid of that. And now I can review and launch. Okay, so I can just check that I've got everything right. It's telling me that I have the RStudio image that I selected from the website. I'm on an M3 large. Now, here, though, I have to be careful, because the security group by default only allows SSH. So I have to go in and select the security group that I created. Okay, so I'm going to select an existing one, and I'm going to choose demo, which is the one that I just set up. Okay, if this is all going very quickly, don't worry. Spasti made the excellent suggestion for me to record this. So if anyone wants the video of it, then you're welcome to get that. So apologies if this is going quick, but it's more to give you a flavour, and then you can come back to it if you want to. So I go back to review and launch and check it's all okay, SSH, HTTP, and I say launch. So then this is the final step. Just a quick show of hand, who has set up on the Gray server's passwordless login so that you can just SSH without passwords? Yeah? So those people, that's what this is about. If you've no idea what I'm talking about, then you can ignore this step and just say, you can change this to proceed without key pair. For the people who know about this and want it, you can create exactly that SSH key pair and specify it here. And you just have to acknowledge that you've got access to it. Probably because Amazon got fed up of people saying, oh, it launched and I've lost my keys. Okay, because then they can't do anything. So then I say to launch, and the instances will now begin to launch. So it's in the queue, essentially, in the data center in Dublin to launch. So I can now go back to EC2 and go to the instances tag. And go to the instances tag. Oh, no. Okay. Is this... Oh, there we are. It's just got hidden for some reason. There we are. So we can see, so this one running in the background was my safety net, because I thought in the tradition of any Blue Peter I should have a here's one I created earlier, just in case it all went wrong. But hopefully the second one down here, which says pending, is the one that I've just created. Okay. So I'm going to have to wait. Oh, it's just updated to running. So now it's changed to running, it's begun booting, but that doesn't mean it will immediately be accessible. So I'm just going to give it another few seconds to carry on booting. And while I do that, I can just go down the bottom here. What you'll see is I have a public DNS and a public IP. So that's how I can access the machine. So if I want to SSH in, then that's the address I SSH to. And if I want to access it through the web, that's the address I put in my browser. Okay, so hopefully I've given it long enough to boot. So I'm going to open a new tab and go to that address, and it's not finished. So I'll give it a minute longer. There we are, it's finished now. So now I have this interface, RStudio, and the default login is just RStudio and RStudio. So when I get logged in there, don't want to save that. Basement wireless is slow. Okay, here we go. So now I effectively have access to RStudio in a browser. And the crucial thing here is that any commands I type down at the bottom, so I wanted to create a random number, that's being done on the server in Dublin. Okay, the interface here is simply sitting in my browser. And if I copy that address, I can close that browser, it's gone away, and if I come back and re-access it, the results are there exactly as I left them. And crucially, if I started a very long-running job and shut the browser, close my laptop, cycle home, open the laptop, open the browser, it will have been running while I was gone. Okay, so the browser doesn't have to be open while it's running. And the only important thing is that, so there's a small package associated with the AMI, which I can load. And the first thing, of course, to do is to change my password, because it comes with just the default RStudio. So I want to just change it to something else, very secure. Okay, so now at least no one else will be able to log in and use this without my knowledge. And then finally, as I said, if I'd launched this, say, as a spot instance, then at any moment, without warning, this could get killed. But even if I'm not launching as a spot instance, it's often nice to be able to monitor what's going on without actually being logged in. So I can link this server to my Dropbox account. So typically what I do is I actually have a separate Dropbox account because I don't want all my photos and stuff syncing onto the server and taking up space. So I have a second Dropbox account I use just for compute work. So if I run link Dropbox, it's launching the Dropbox client on the Amazon server. And then it will come back in a moment when it's done with a URL. And then I copy and paste that URL into my browser and I just authenticate it to access my Dropbox account. So it's going to take a second. Okay. So you'll notice that the interface is paused while it waits for me to do this, because it will confirm that I have linked the account when I've finished. So I paste that into a browser, Let me just check I'm on the correct account here, am I? Yep. So it's, would I like to connect this to my Dropbox account? I say connect. It says your computer is successfully linked. Continue. And now if I go back, it's detected that it's linked to Dropbox, and you'll see that a Dropbox folder has appeared in the pane over here. Now the important thing, this file pane is on the server. It's not a local view of my files on my laptop. So if I go in there, you'll see that it's begun to copy across all of the files from my Dropbox account. Okay. And similarly, if I edit any of these or create a new file, that will sync directly up to Dropbox. So if I wanted to, I can set my compute job going and have it save out intermediate results into Dropbox, just put it into that Dropbox folder. And then I can just monitor my Dropbox and see when the compute job's done. And I can then remotely kill the server without having to log in and download the results and so on.
Okay.
So that's kind of the workflow that I think works fairly well.
How am I doing on time?
I said I wouldn't go for 2 hours, but I'd better go for a bit more than an hour. Okay, we're just over an hour.
Okay, so I've just about got time. I'll quickly describe spot instances and then give you a quick view of what it's like to work with Docker, which is a little bit more complicated. So hopefully, I think, is that vaguely convincing that that's not really too difficult? Okay, it's mostly just clicking through a few things. The only complicated step was making sure that the firewall let me through by setting SSH and HTTP to the correct thing. But in the matter of, you know, about 3 or 4 minutes, I've got access to potentially a server with, you know, 40 cores and a quarter of a terabyte of RAM. Okay, so machines that are almost as good as the grey machines. But that machine is just for you. Okay, it's not going to be used by anyone else. And you can write as much as you like to the disk and not crash the department. Okay. So, just to quickly explain spot instances, because what's happened there, I've launched an M3 large. Let me now just go and look at the pricing here, and we can see what that is. I think the wireless actually is worse in the basement. Here we are, pricing. So if I go down and look at, say, Ireland, so I launched an M3 large, so that's costing me 14.6 cents per hour, which is not a lot. If I'd actually gone to launch one of the big ones, say up here, the 40-core one with 120 gig, that would be $2.64 an hour. Still not really much, because that's dollars as well, so it's maybe £2 an hour or whatever. But it adds up pretty quickly, okay, particularly if you're running this for 24, 48 hours. So instead, you can launch spot instances, and you just go to the spot request page here, and I can look initially here at the pricing history. So let's look actually at the M4... Which one was it? M4 10XL. Okay, so this is the price history on the spot market for the one that costs $260 normally. So, you know, on a good day, down in this area here, I can launch it for about 33 cents instead of $2.60. So that's a really big difference. So this is over the course of a day how the price is changing. I can look at a longer range. So over the past month, we'll probably see some bigger spikes in price when the wireless catches up. Yeah, okay, so here we are. So some serious spikes in price here, okay, to $11.88, which is crazy, okay, because people are paying more than the on-demand price. You might think this is a bit strange. It is a bit strange, and people didn't realize actually when it first launched that Amazon didn't cap the price. So some people ended up paying $1,000 an hour because they just thought the easiest thing, they couldn't be bothered to check what the price was, and so they just put $1,000 in. And then the spot market got overloaded and there weren't enough instances, so of course the price rose, and some people were paying $1,000 an hour for something that they could launch on demand for a couple of dollars. So you might ask why, you know, this seems irrational behavior, but the reality is that if you desperately need the compute capacity and they don't have any on-demand instances available, you can pay over the odds and get a spot instance. So if there was no capacity on M410XL instances, you could go on the spot market and bid more than they actually cost for their fixed price. But the other thing you'll notice here is that typically this seems to only happen in a few data centers. And this is very, very common. If you work with spot instances a lot, I use them almost exclusively because I'm tight. what you notice is that typically this only happens in a couple of data centers. And the reason for that is that there are a lot of high-performance applications or database applications where the instances must be physically in the same data center, maybe for performance reasons or something like that. So probably this yellow data center has some big company in it who have to have their instances launched there. And so if that particular data center runs out of capacity, the price there can spike. Whereas, so what you'll notice here is that, say, the red data center has never spiked above the on-demand price. Okay, so it's an underutilized data center compared to the other two. So often I would look at the history and say, well, which one is least likely to kill me? In other words, here, over the last month, if I was to bid in the region of 211, say, in the red data center, I'd have some confidence that it's very unlikely my job running for 24 hours will get killed, but I will only pay whatever the market rate is. So that, just to clarify as well, if I bid $1,000, but the spot price is 30 cents, I only pay 30 cents. I pay the market rate. So you might say that's a little cumbersome. It is. If anyone wants this script, I'm happy to give it to them. So this is a little script I wrote, because otherwise you have to go into every data center around the world. You have to go through that list in the drop-down box. So this is a script which goes to each of the data centers and queries the current spot price for an instance which is specified in the script. And then you can compare across regions. So for example, here the most expensive region at the moment is US East Data Center E, which is $6. But right now, so if I wanted to launch an M410XL now, it looks like I'd probably want to launch it in Germany, okay, because that's 32 cents, whereas where I'm looking at the moment, EU West, is over 50 cents. Okay, so I can choose the instance I want and get a snapshot image of where is the cheapest place in the world to launch it right now. Okay, so I then go in, say I want to do this, so I'm not actually going to launch one, I'll just show you the only thing that changes. So let's say I'm going to launch this, choose any old instance. So you remember we had this page before, but we didn't do anything on it, and I said we'd need to come back to it. So now, because we're on the spot instance, it says request spot instance, and it gives me the current prices here, and I have to put in my maximum bid. So I can say bid 50 cents, and then launch the instance. And as long as my bid is high enough, it will launch. That's the only difference. Everything else, setting the security group, choosing the AMI, it's all otherwise the same as launching the on-demand instance. And typically a spot instance will take about 60 seconds to 5 minutes longer to launch because it has to match the spot prices before it launches the instance. So there's sort of a second queue that it has to go through. Okay. So then finally, yep, I'll be finished in 15 minutes, so I will have saved 25% of your time. let's have a quick look at doing Docker. So is anyone familiar with Docker? Quick show of hands. Vague, yep, one or two people have heard of it. Okay, so Docker is essentially a service which allows you to package up software into little discrete units that you can install on virtual machines. So you can think of it as a bit like the R package system, but for operating systems, in a sense. So you have Docker containers, which are the operating systems, so that wraps up like a bare-bones Linux machine. And then you have Docker images, which is software, such as R or Julia, which you can launch into those containers. And EC2 has jumped on board with this. So Docker is completely independent of Amazon. It works with a lot of different cloud providers. And Amazon have got their own sort of interface that allows you to work with Docker containers. And that's called ECS, imaginatively, Elastic Container Service.
Everything is elastic.
Okay, so there's essentially two... there are three things to do here. The first is that the way that Amazon have set it up is slightly unusual. You have to first give your instance permissions, security permissions, to interface to the container service which manages it. The second thing you have to do is create a cluster, even if you only want one machine, because Docker is usually used with clusters. Even if you only want one machine, you have to create a cluster. And then finally, you have to create a task, which is Amazon language for matching up a Docker image. Okay. So the first thing you need to do, I'm going to go in here. This IAM is Amazon speak for Identity Access Management. That's the security stuff. So you need to go in here and create what's called a role. So I created one here called ASD, very imaginatively. So you just create a new role. I'm really doing this for the purposes of the video. I don't expect anyone to remember what I'm doing right now. So I do an ECS. And then I just need to give it a role, which you'll find down here if I go down. Right, there are two, and it's easy to mix them up. One gives permission for an instance to talk to the container service. The other gives the container service permission to manage the instances. Okay, you need to get this the right way around. So you want the EC2 instance to access ECS. So this is the role that you need to provide. So you choose that one, tick, next step, and create. Okay. So these two roles should now actually be identical. So that's step one. Step two, I need to go back now to my container service, and I need to create a cluster. So I'm going to leave my test cluster there, because that's my blue piece of something I did earlier in case this goes horribly wrong, because this is slightly more complicated than the AMI. So I create a cluster, and I'm going to call it grad lecture. Okay, and that's it. It's just it. All a cluster is a name that I give to the cluster. Then the next thing I need to do is to launch an instance into the cluster. Okay, so I've got a cluster, but now I need some machines running. Okay, so I'm going to jump back to EC2, and I pop over to instances, and I'm going to launch another instance. I have to remember to kill these. I'm probably going to wake up tomorrow morning and go, "Oh my god, no, I forgot to kill those after the demo." And Amazon have, they have an optimized AMI. They call it an optimized AMI, which comes with all of the Docker kind of infrastructure built into it. So if you do a search for Amazon ECS OPT, that's their Elastic Container Service optimized image. What you'll find is there are loads of them, okay, because they change them every quarter. So you can just narrow it with this year as well. And they just do this because a lot of companies need sort of continuity of the software stack. So this is the most recent one. This is the first quarter image there. So I select to launch that AMI. So you'll notice the difference here is now I'm launching a Docker AMI rather than directly launching RStudio as an AMI. And now I just choose the image that I want. So I'll do another M3 large. That was a nice instance. And I configure the instance details. And now this is where, again, Docker is a little bit more complicated. As I said, the AMI route is easy. It's fast, but it's a bit more restricted. Docker is powerful, a bit slower to get going, but you could launch any software that exists in Docker, which is pretty much all software. So what do I need to do? Well, I need to give this image permission to talk to my container service. Okay. So I choose the role, I've chosen the role I set up, just because I know that one definitely works. I hope that one would work as well, but I'm not going to risk it. And then I need to do another thing here, and that is I need to tell the instance which cluster it's going to join. And unfortunately, this is the slightly inelegant part of the whole process. So there is a script that looks like this, and I just need to replace this with grad lecture, because that's the name of the cluster I want it to join. And I copy and paste this script which is in the Amazon documentation, by the way.
I haven't just pulled this out of thin air. So all this is saying is bin bash is just saying it's a shell script, and it's going to echo this line, which is saying join the cluster ground lecture, and it puts it into the cluster setup file.
All you do is you find this in the Amazon documentation, you change the cluster name to your cluster. Okay, so still not very complicated, it's just an extra step. And I can go through to review and launch now. And all I want to do is change my security group and for exactly the same reasons. And I'm just going to use one I created earlier, which has a couple of extra rules.
So if you're launching RStudio in Docker, the port is different. It's not on the standard web port. And if you're launching Julia in Docker, it's on a different port again. Okay, so these are the ports you need. The first one for RStudio 8787. And quadruple 8 is for Julia.
And, you know, if you launch a Docker image, you just go to the documentation, it will tell you what port it is on. Okay, so I now go review and launch. Check that that's got my new security group. Okay, hope that everything's right. Have I got all the stuff there? Yep, so launch. I've got the keys, so that's fine. Launch. Okay, fingers crossed. Now, when I go back, I hope this works. Okay, hopefully this soon is going to update. I have to wait. Well, let's go and actually see when the instance launches. Okay, so it's still pending. That's why I'm waiting.
Until that goes active, it's not going to join the grad lecture cluster.
Okay. What's the time? Yep. I'll be done in a few minutes, don't worry. Running. Excellent. Okay. So it's now started to boot, so I've got to wait and give it long enough to run that script that I pasted into the user information, because that's what tells it what cluster to join. Okay. Oh no, it's my blue piece of demo going wrong. What I'm waiting for is that this 0 should increment to 1
if my container registers successfully against my instance.
Oh, it's not looking good. Says it's still initializing, so I'll give it a little bit longer. You can see already this is taking a lot longer than launching an AMI. Okay, so this is why Docker is powerful. Ah, there we are, fantastic. I've got a 1. Okay, so now I go in here, I've got an instance registered to my cluster. Okay, so we're nearly there. Now I need to create a task, which is the Amazon language for the image that I'm going to launch in here. So I'm going to, I did do RStudio as well, but I'm going to skip that because, well, we've seen that already. So I've already set it up here, but I'm just going to go through and do it again so you can see. So I'm going to create a task which I'll call, well, let's call it Jupiter this time. So I create a task called Jupiter, and I need to add a container to it. I'm just going to call the container the same thing. And then I just need to remind myself what the... So here, this is the
Docker image that allows you to launch a Jupyter notebook, which has Julia built in. So that's the name of the
Docker image. So I need to copy that. Okay. And that's my... Oops, get rid of the last slash. And then you can assign however much of the memory of that system you want to it. And then, as I said, Jupyter works on quadruple 8 as the port. So I just do that. I don't need to worry about the advanced stuff here. And I'm going to add that as my service and create. Okay. So now when I look at my tasks, I have the Jupyter, which I've just made. And the last step, finally, is I go back to my grad lecture cluster and I create a service which is defined by Jupyter. And I'm going to call it Jupyter service. And I want one, that's just saying I launch on one of my servers. Say I was using this in the sort of more traditional sense and I was launching a whole cluster, I could specify how many servers I want to launch Jupyter on here. Okay. And then these are health things, so there's extra stuff in the background because this is used a lot by businesses running websites. And the Amazon can detect when a server crashes and relaunch a new one, that kind of stuff. We don't really worry about that. So I'm going to create that service, go and view it. Okay, so here we have Jupyter service is active. So if I go and have a look, and hopefully in a minute this is going to update. And when this is updated and it shows pending, as I said, I did this earlier and it took about 5 minutes because this is copying the entire Jupyter installation from online. Okay, so there we are. It started, and that is currently pending. So that has begun copying Jupyter across. So I'm now just going to cheat and go to the one I made earlier and show you that if I take the IP address and I add quadruple 8 to the end, that brings up a Jupyter interface here. And I can then just create a notebook, or here's a notebook I made earlier with some simple Julia example in it, and I can run that and get the code to execute. And again, I can launch as my back-end instance here, I could have launched a 40-core, quarter of a terabyte machine and do my computation locally on that. Okay, are there any questions about cloud? That was an awful lot, but are there any questions about that?
Do you have an integration of Dropbox and Jupyter?
No, I didn't actually write that Docker image.
Okay.
But that's a good question. I am tempted to make a Jupyter AMI, because I have to say my preference is for AMIs. They're just so much quicker to set up. Like, they're slower for me because I have to make them. But then when people use them, they're launched in 2 minutes flat. Rather than, you saw the multiple steps you go through with Docker. Because Docker is very flexible, it's brilliant because you have so much flexibility, but as a result you have to define instances connected to clusters, launching images, and you know, wait for the images to copy remotely, and you know. So maybe in come back to me in 6 months. Any other questions?
You showed us before the RStudio interface.
Mm-hmm.
Can we do the parallel computing thing that you were explaining before with GPUs?
Yes, yep. So Amazon have, if I go to their instance page again, so they have actually got instances which have GPU support. So if I go right down. So they have actually... Oh yeah, so this is the most current generation. So they have instances which have support for NVIDIA GPUs with 1,500 cores. And you could launch an AMI which plugged into this and then download the R packages which support GPUs and go from there. There's a little bit more work because you've got extra stuff to download, but fundamentally it's the same. Cool. Brilliant. Well, I saved you half an hour there, so half an hour shorter grand lecture, but hopefully it was useful.